Hi, everyone. Welcome to Office Hours. If you're watching on YouTube, you can find out more about what we do at officehours.global. First hour is general discussion, media and virtual production, whatever questions come up. The second hour is usually something we want to spend a little bit more time on. And today we're going to talk about the Belfast Method. This is our remote takeover process. The whole team's going to be here talking about how it actually gets done. It's going to be a really interesting second hour. Tomorrow, we're going to talk about shoestring budgets. Most of us started not with a bunch of equipment or trucks or anything else, but with a computer and a webcam. So we're going to talk about approaches to that and how to be successful. And then on Saturday, of course, we have EDU in the morning. I know it's the 25th. People keep on asking, are you really going to do that? Yes, we are. So a lot of the educators wanted to still have that morning. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And then a reminder that at 2 o'clock this afternoon and tomorrow afternoon, we will have Isadora with Elle and hopefully a couple other folks. So stay tuned for that and make sure to join us. All right. Well, let's go ahead and jump into the questions. Bill, what do we have?
The first one comes from our own Doug Ferguson here in the panel in Indianapolis, Indiana. He says, if I crew freelancers for a day rate and my production goes over, say, 3 hours, what should I pay the crew for the overtime?
Go ahead, Marty.
So I think that's part of project management and advanced planning and making sure that you have talked with your client in advance. If there's any expectation that the show will go long or the hours will go over what is typically expected, that should be built into the budget as an assumption. Maybe not the maximum, but somewhere in the middle so that, you know, if the show goes short, people come away happy.
Go ahead, Courtney.
3 hours is a bit short to go into overtime. In California, at least, the state regulations are 8 hours. You're required to pay overtime after eight. It depends on what you've negotiated with your crew. And like was said previously, you understand, you make it clear to the client if they booked you for a certain amount of time that how much overtime will cost if you exceed that amount of time. So that's negotiable in advance. As far as state regulations and requirement to pay overtime, most states it's after 8 hours. You have to pay time and a half. And in a production, of course, I don't know if that 3 hours, maybe it's a typo, maybe you meant 8 hours, it's 8 hours. That includes, you know, pre-production and everything, call time to wrap time.
Go ahead, Sky.
I'm also curious if we need to look at other trades, because there are certain hours that certain, like a carpenter or a plumber, but again, what is the service that we're providing? And also the client isn't doing this every day. So I always find this question regionally challenging, because in New York and LA, there are very strict union specified, you know, criterias and expectations. So where you live, there might be different regional expectations. And again, video production may not be your client's everyday concept. So that would be a challenge too. And I see Courtney stepping in. So I'd love to hear Courtney's perspective on regional hourly and also client expectations.
Go ahead, Courtney.
I was just going to mention, I did mention union, because collective bargaining agreements supersede any state law. So if you're covered under a collective bargaining agreement, in other words, a union shoot, that would take precedence as to when overtime is paid, as opposed to whatever the state regulations are.
But what would you say to a regional aspect of this question? In Dallas, would it be different than in Cincinnati?
It depends. You know, it depends on the norm. I like in Los Angeles, a lot of commercial productions work on a 10-hour day, but so you bid it based on a 10-hour day instead of an 8-hour day or a 12-hour day. Some people use a 12-hour day to bid, but they have to make that information available up front so that you know what you're bidding on when you're bidding your day rate. And if you're not covered by a collective bargaining agreement, a lot of times what they'll do is they'll hire a payroll company that will have to adhere to the state rules. So if they book you on a 10-hour day, they back calculate how much your rate would be if you were paid at 8 hours of regular time plus 2 hours of time and a half. And that would end up being the rate you negotiated for the 10-hour day. So they kind of make it work in both situations like that.
Now go ahead, Doug.
Yeah, so I was kind of looking more of like not union rates, but like let's say I'm doing a college soccer game and I got three college students that are doing, you know, I hey, the gig is $100 or the gig is $200. And then, I don't know, there's a rain delay and then we go over, you know, something that's unexpected. Like, should I take that rate and divide it by the hours to get what I should pay them ahead of time? Or should I just, like you said, double it or that I'm kind of getting at the calculation of the overtime, not the union, so much the union stuff.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, you divide the day rate by the number of hours that have been agreed upon in pre-production, say, 10-hour day, and time and a half means each hour costs 1.5 the hourly rate if you divide it equally. And usually, well, in our case, I do 10 hours, and from the 10th hour up to the 14th hour is time and a half, and after that is double time. And if the turnaround time to the next shooting day is less than 12 hours, the double time continues. So that's nice for, it gives us a nice payday.
Next question.
Alan Buckhead is up next, and he's from North in the UK, and he says, can someone describe the Belfast method in a couple of sentences? There's a lot of time spent on the show on it, but I missed it when it was born, so I'd like to hear an overview. Thanks.
Great, and we'll, of course, talk about this in detail in the second hour, but we'll go ahead and do this. Go ahead, Tlaloc.
I like to think of it as decentralized production. So it is a theater in Belfast that we have put together a system and a methodology to bring people from all over the world to help cut the show in terms of vision mixing, audio mixing, as well as PTZ camera control and lighting. So it gives us a decentralized ability to bring help and experimentation in from around the world.
Go ahead, Rupert.
There's been some good press coverage of the Belfast Method on NPR and on PC Magazine. I'll post some links in Mukana.
Go ahead, Sky.
I think the other word would be remote control in the sense of the crew, because normally you would have a room full of equipment, tape decks, distributing things, which the Belfast Theater does have, but the people that are operating most of that equipment are somewhere else in the world. So replacing that 35-foot production truck that rolls up outside of a stadium.
Let's jump to the next question.
Jonas Totel in Stuttgart, Germany says, did anybody notice the, and then he just paused there, and after views in YouTube, what does it mean?
Jonas?
So I noticed when I look at videos, sometimes after the views, there are 3 points. And I first thought that's a bug. And now I looked at it deeply, and sometimes on some channels, there's just a point and then the date. But so it's like, this is the YouTube channel and there it's always the same. But then if I go to my channel, I have the 3 points again. And then if I go to other people's channels, they also have the points. And if they have the points, it's on the whole channel. And it's really interesting because I don't find any correlation other than the channel. It's not like
what
live.
Is it showing
it's
again?
Not, it's really minor, but it's also really weird. So after the views here, it shows that amount of views, and then it shows a dot or point. And it's really weird.
Interesting.
Sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. And every time YouTube does something weird, I want to try to figure out what I can do to make it not look weird.
Yeah. I have no idea what that is. Go ahead, Bill.
Well, in typesetter terms, ellipsis, which are the 3 dots technical name, means that there was more text that was truncated or there's a pause there. So I'm wondering if it was auto cut down from a bigger piece of text.
Yeah, go ahead, John.
Looking at what you were showing us, Jonas, it looks like it's auto-scaling, and some of the numbers were longer for the view counts, and in other cases, the font sizes had been scaled differently, and so it looks like it's just an automation of the formatting through CSS that's used to balance out the area where the data is shown.
Let's jump to the next question.
It looks like Sajax Tours in South Carolina, and I'm sorry if I messed your name up, sir or madam, perhaps a sort of crash course integration to the Discord would be helpful. I know there are plans for cleanup, but how does that look realistically?
I don't know how much cleanup we'll do anytime soon. I mean, I know people want to delete things, but then those are things that people were talking about. So we'll see what we do there. I might look at things that have not been used for a long, long time. I think that the best thing to do is go into after hours and just ask people questions. I think that, you know, it's hard for us to describe that here. But I think that the main thing is to look for the things that you're interested in, you know, and look for the things that are new. You'll see things get highlighted after you come by. So if you mark everything as red, then you'll start to see what conversations are popping up. Next question.
Comes from Ruben McRae here on the panel, often from Dallas, Texas. When I switch to a Blackmagic 6K Pro, what lenses would you recommend for my shot? I would like to keep my background basically in focus. The far point in my background is 16 feet. I have 4 foot free in front of me. I intend to rent and test whatever suggestions come up here.
I go ahead, TJ.
The thing you're going to need to look at is your field of view right now that you have established with your Brio camera. And so you're going to probably be looking somewhere in the 30 to 40 millimeter range, I'm guessing. So there's a couple of lenses that cover that. I would recommend a zoom lens because that allows you adjustments without having to physically move the camera. And if you are wanting to keep the entire thing in focus, you're going to have to step down and be shooting at somewhere around like f8 or even a bit higher. So you're going to need a lot of light.
All right, go ahead, Mickey.
I would probably go with the one of the holy trinity of Canon L lenses, the 16-35 or the 24-70, the other one being the 70-200. For your shot, Rupert, I think if you want to emulate what you have now, 16-35 might work better, because the sharpest point of a zoom lens would be somewhere in the middle. But if you want a lens with a bit more flexibility, 24-70. But
mm-hmm. Go ahead, Peter.
I've had really good luck with my 24-70 Canon lens. Again, lots of light so that it can step down if it needs to, but and then let it do its thing and it'll figure it out. But it's a zoom lens, so you can adjust where you're going in terms of what the field of view is, carefully.
John. Yep. John?
And to echo again, the 24-70, I'm using the Sigma. I wanted to save a little bit of money, and it's a really good lens for the price. Although I also have the Canon lens, and it's a fantastic lens. I just don't want to tie it up for this. I want to keep it on my regular camera.
You go, Jason.
Nothing to add that hasn't already been said.
Yeah, our standard issue is Canon L series 24-70. The Sigma looks great too. We just find that, especially at about 4 feet, which is about what my camera is, you're going to be at about 35, maybe a little wider. And the problem really is that if you do 16-35, which is what I used in the past, you're right at the end of the lens. A lot of the time, and so it's just a struggle. The 24-70 gives you more of a closer to just more room around what you're doing. Next question.
Ray Harwood in Avondale, Arizona says, while good office hours metrics numbers are not our end goal, what statistics are available for trend analysis? Is there a way to view percent of producers in Zoom actively logged into Mukana, for example?
I have that ability. we don't publish that process. I mean, there is some data as far as number of people and so on and so forth that we can see on the back end, but we don't have a way for that to be publicly viewed at the moment. Next question.
Mitchell Hill, Wilmington, Delaware, also on the panel this morning, says, thinking about using a TV screen behind me, not sure about the math to get a proper zoom to eliminate the TV bezel. Room is 11 feet deep. The suggestions, a Sony X91J 85-inch TV and a Chief LPE 1U electric lift cart.
Go ahead, Courtney.
Sounds like a nice setup. The ability to actually calculate that with math is fairly complex. You can find a field of view calculator online at the scantips.com location. And it does talk in here about the values. It's an interactive chart. You can enter your field of view with the lens, and you have to know the focal size, the focal length of your lens, the size of the sensor, and the distance to the screen, etc. However, it's if you're off in any one of those, you know, the millimeter of the lens or the size of the sensor or the distance, the numbers will come out all wrong. The easiest way is just to stick it out there and point the camera at it. If it's a zoom lens, then zoom until the bezel is out, and then position yourself so that the depth of field puts the screen at a focus level that you like. Whether you want it out of focus or in focus, you'll have to choose an aperture that will give you the correct depth of field for what you're looking for.
All right, go ahead, Mitchell.
Yeah, Courtney, thanks for that answer. That's way more math than my little brain can handle. But I was thinking that, you know, I was going to do a lot with the lighting to try to get the background dealt with. And then yesterday we were talking about TV screens behind us. And I guess in just guessing terms, 2 feet, 3 feet behind me with 85 inches, how big does it have to be to keep the bezel out of the picture? That's what I'm looking for.
85 is a really big TV. so we've never done more than 80 for the TVs that we've used. So that's something to kind of think through. And most of our TVs for behind people have been about 70 inches. And so I think that you can't make it work, in my opinion, less than 70. But obviously you can get more distance between you and the TV if it's 85. So 85 will be easier to push it back. I think you're probably going to end up with the TV at 85, you're probably going to end up with the TV at about 3 feet behind you, you know, or could, you know, and that's going to give you some relatively good depth of field. Remember that the other thing, cool thing about the TV is you can blur the image behind you too. So you can create a forced blur look. Don't go too crazy with that. It looks weird. But the main thing you want to do is have your depth of field short enough that it blurs out the pixels in the screen. And so the larger the screen, the further those pixels are apart, even on a 4K. So you just have to remember that you getting too big can actually make it harder because the actual sites are actually further apart, which will create more moray and potentially, you know, more patterns. Go ahead, Rupert.
This gets discussed so much. I think we just need to establish the widths of some of these screen sizes and then make a yardstick of that measurement, and you can take it back in your shot and see where that size TV fits.
I mean, the other thing you can do, I mean, for me, a lot of times I figure that stuff out with 3D models. So I set the camera up with a field of view in Cinema 4D or SketchUp and throw the TV in based on the measurements and start playing around with it. And then I can figure it all out exactly. And I find that that's usually within a couple inches of accuracy. Next question.
Comes from Hasma Kajar, our show friend in Cape Town, South Africa. He says, I'm using OBS to bring in meters, but it's a CPU hog on the Mac. No windows, please. I did this with MIMO Live before, but any changes on screen over the meters window would show up in Zoom. Thoughts?
I go ahead, Marty.
So the best information is audio coming from both directions, and you want to meter this from as a viewer would hear it. So that would mean metering a Zoom client and on a different machine. So having a different machine with a Zoom client logged in and then metering from that will give you both sides of the conversation as the viewers hear it.
All right, go ahead, TJ.
David Brady and I have been experimenting with using NDI as the capture method of the window, and it's much lighter weight. However, the base NDI does not have what's called a region of interest area to grab. It's only available on the window side, but there are a couple of third-party add-ons that supposedly do that region of interest, so you can capture part of the window. And so haven't looked into actually acquiring in that because they cost a bit more money.
Go ahead, Jeffrey.
CamTwist is the other free alternative for Mac, and you can get it at CamTwist Studio. I put the link in the show notes. The other thing to do is you can grab a capture card, and if you have an HDMI out, you just basically loop the screen. You full screen the WL meter on that and then loop it into your capture card, and then you can bring that in independently into Zoom.
Next question.
Next one comes to us from Dan Goldstein in Westchester, New York. He says, I just spun up a Decklink card in a Sonnet Echo Express SE, and I'm hearing a light ticking as if the cooling fan is hitting something. Both are brand new. Is that something I should be concerned with?
Go ahead, Tlaloc.
Yeah, I think you should be very concerned with that if you have any kind of wire that's intruding into the pathway of the fan. That's going to chafe through and you'll have problems down the road. So go in, visually inspect it, see if you see anything obvious. And then worst case scenario, you have an issue with a bearing in the fan, and then you'll have to replace the fan. But really keep an eye on that.
Mickey?
Yeah, Tala covered a lot of it. But just do know that unplugging and replugging it in the fan of both the Sonnet box and also the Decklink fan, because that card, a lot of the Decklinks also have fans. Unplugging the fan is very easy, and you can reroute it or twist it around so that it doesn't hit the fan.
All right, go ahead, Jason.
Although I haven't had that problem with the Sonnet box, it's my default practice to switch out any sort of even remotely look cheap-looking fan on any box and any card immediately.
The only thing I have to add is that Tarlok looks really good coming in from a hotel. the lighting and setup is really good. Well done. I was looking down. I was like, wow, that turned out really well. All right, next question.
Comes to us from TJ Asher in Minneapolis, Minnesota, here on the panel. I finally had a chance to see some of the behind the scenes of Tony's show last night. That's Conversations with Tony Mobley. There was a TD calling the show and Aaron was doing the switching. Who was calling the show? It was an exemplary learning experience to hear that.
Go ahead, TJ.
Yeah, just listening to the show and whomever was calling it, I don't know, and hopefully Tlaloc will tell. After a while, Aaron and whomever was calling the show just got into a sync mentally, and the person calling didn't even have to make the calls because Aaron was already doing the things that the person calling wanted. It was really cool to watch.
Go ahead, Tlaloc.
So that was Brian Shand, and Brian Shand is a really fantastic human being and has jumped in all over this community and has done a great job and is learning super, super fast and doing a lot of great things. And the way it works, we always do have, as you say, we have a calling person and we have a TD. And Manolo is usually the TD and he couldn't this week. So Aaron Hustledge was the TD, which usually Aaron Hustledge calls. But it was serendipitous because we were already bringing in Brian to call this week. So all that being said, I really want to make a call out for everybody here to reach out and see if you can be part of this process and part of this project, because it's a lot of fun and it's very rewarding and we need people. There was a moment yesterday where we had issues with a YouTube commenter, and I was a little distracted in my role as executive producer. And so Laura jumped in and was helping me with that. And so we need people like that. So please let us know. Thank you so much.
And with a lot of those things, before we jump to Tony there, with a lot of the things, when things get started is the time to get in. So you want to, this is the best time right now to be on the panel, to be working on Office Hours 2.0, to be working on the Mobley, it's a conversation with Tony Mobley, the Belfast Method. This is the time when it's loose and anybody can jump in. There will be times when these become the cool shows and it takes a lot of time and application to get in. So definitely, if you want to learn this, this is the time to do it. Go ahead, Tony.
I just wanted to say thank you, Laura, and thank you, Brian, for last night, and of course the team so much. And we, as Alex said, we are looking for more help if you have the time. This is very cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Next question.
Comes to us from Tony Mobley in Noonan, Georgia. Houses of worship I'm working with uses PowerPoint to display any information needed during the worship service. Any suggestions? And he notes it's problematic for me as an office hour member.
Go ahead, David.
I assume that you're talking about using PowerPoint or Keynote or something in a digital context, that is to say through Zoom or YouTube or something like that. I do that all the time. This is how I share my liturgy when I'm leading services. And I think for me, the most important thing is don't rely on the PowerPoint or the keynote to convey whatever it is that you want to convey. If it's there to support you in creating an experience, great. Don't rely on it solely.
Yeah, go ahead, Marty.
Yeah, that's a really good point, David. If it's problematic to use PowerPoint because of its quirks or something, PowerPoint can work very well. You need to learn how to use it, how to display it without borders or menus at the top. But there, depending on what you're using to switch your cameras, if you're using OBS or something, you can use tools within OBS to show slides and videos and such. That's another way of bringing content into the event. There are, and there are other tools as well. You can use Microsoft Publisher or any other publisher type of program. If you don't want to rely on PowerPoint, look for other ways to bring in the content.
Go ahead, John.
Yeah, so I come from House of Worship often. Most of the time we're using like ProPresenter, which is a non-linear workflow, which allows you to kind of jump between things. There's a lot of multimedia content. Really great software solution. Media Shout's another one. Proclaim's a good one. Those are both more affordable options that I've used in the past. But ProPresenter is definitely number one. Even has some live streaming capabilities now built into it with Resi, which is a great platform for multi-streaming.
I go ahead, Tony.
Yeah, the issue is that we're seeing a lot of the mouse movements and all of the other slides showing during the Zoom. And so it's problematic for me. I don't think it's an issue for anybody else but me. But I just wanted some suggestions in order to shift it.
So the problem there is that that the person running it is not going into presentation mode. They want to control the slides, and so they're not going into presentation mode. That's why you're seeing all the mousing and you're seeing the slides down the side. So they have to go into presentation mode, so that it's, and then it just is what it is. It's not clicking to other slides. It's go up there and go to the next slide, knowing what you have for the next slide. That's the, and Keynote makes that a little easier because you can present to a window, which makes it a lot easier to kind of manage what happens there. So it's a lot if you're looking at those things, but if it's PowerPoint, they have to go into presentation mode to get out of that. But that's why you're seeing the extra slides and the mousing, which would be super distracting for me. next question.
Comes to us from Marty Adias here in the panel from Maryland. I'm initialing a new PC for production and my DAW. With so many different ways that plugins get licensed, it could take several days to get everything installed. Is there any tips for making migrating to a new machine easier?
I go, Jeffrey.
With PC, you have the migration process. So basically, if you're logged into the same machine on both machines, it can transfer things over. And they're really working on making the licenses also transfer over as well. It's really going to depend up to the individual software to do it. Other than that, if you really want a clean machine, you could mirror everything and just bring it over that way. Sometimes licenses work that way. But if you really want a clean machine, you've got to start from scratch.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I would start by standardizing on how you license your software on all your systems. The way I do it, each room I have has a license key for the DAW and another license key for plugins. Of course, aside from the plugins that can only be licensed via software. And we transfer all of those using the mostly alot keys. We also have hasp keys, but keeping everything the same amongst all your systems, all your machines, could speed things up. We also have a NAS share that's all the recent versions of all the software, and I could build up an entire system from reformat to ready to roll in maybe 5-6 hours.
Go ahead, Mitchell.
What Mickey was just suggesting is handy, particularly if you travel or you're a freelancer and you work from one machine to another in another state, in another area, and you just take that USB dongle and plug it into the machine and bingo, there's your plugins. But if it's on your machine and it's not going anywhere, for the most part, a lot of these companies have their own software. For example, I use a lot of Waves plugin, and I'm occasionally rebuilding a machine, and I need to be able to do exactly what you're doing. Waves has a program called Waves Central that manages all the plugins and the licenses, and it sort of sorts and gathers and updates and does all kinds of stuff. I find that the company or the software organization, as John was referring to, usually has the best way to manage it, and a lot of times it's just push the button and off it goes, and you go have a sandwich while it's updating all the plugins.
Go ahead, Jason.
If I can avoid an app whose only purpose is to license and spew whatever it wants about me in the background at any given time, I will. I like alot, but if you don't have one, this is probably not the right time to start using one. My advice is completely independent of any of this, which is get a password manager. LastPass uses secure notes and has a wonderful template for storing software information.
Next question.
Hasmek is back from Cape Town, South Africa with this one. There was some chatter in After Hours on this. If we create a rookie's guide videos or create rookie's guide videos for newcomers to Office Hours and After Hours, how much detail should we include? A TRS mic jack or quarter inch jack, headphone jack or 3.5 inch HP jack or TRS? He's just noting there's a lot of complexity.
Go ahead, talk.
So I'm of two minds about this. I think that there's a lot of value in coming into After Hours and saying, I don't know how to do this thing. And even if it's a thing that we've just talked about a bunch of times over and over and over again, because that person is getting that information right when they need it. And what's valuable to us is that we get to really hone our understanding of that thing as we help them through it. Happened last night with certain things too. And so I've been thinking a little bit more about this. Yeah, I think videos are good, but I think After Hours is better.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I totally agree. After Hours is better. But I think specific to what Hasmuk mentioned, like TRS doesn't describe what size the connector is. And also what quarter inch doesn't describe how many poles the connector is. So I think getting really detailed is important. And also, I think Hasmuk was creating a video specifically about the Mix Pre line or Mix Pre 6, I believe. I would, for that, I would go into the manufacturer's documentation and follow what they mentioned there, because the person who's watching your video might also have the user guide or the manual open, and them being able to line things up would be useful.
All right, go ahead, Bill.
Yeah, two people have mentioned it, and I agree with it. When I was making informational, like, here's a directory of how to use this new tool stuff, if I had a secondary place to send them, and we have After Hours, which is brilliant, I would try to give them a general instruction and say, come to After Hours for more details, rather than trying to cover all the use cases and variable in the actual produced video. That's always worked well for me. Video for the general hint, but give them a place to go to get the specifics that take too long to do in a video.
Go ahead, Hasmuk.
Yeah, am I hearing that there's actually no place or no need for videos for newcomers to our community? I mean, I just don't know. I'm conflicted at the moment.
Yeah, I don't think that's the case. I think that we could definitely build little videos. And I think that there are lots of little tips and tricks like, hey, to do this, I wouldn't try to get too comprehensive. I think that's the point of trying to solve every problem. But lots of little things like when you hear this or things we notice. And it'd be great to have a note somewhere, maybe even some kind of note section within Mukana that we're seeing something like, hey, we should probably make a video about this. I think that the videos, if the video is longer than 60 to 90 seconds, I think that there's too much detail in it. I think that it should just be something that is real quick little tips of how to do something that people can go back and refer to. I think that those are going to make a big difference. And I think that I have a long list of things that someday I'll make as far as videos of because I think that the main thing is that I think that we can, because we're really trying to serve the audience and because we're not trying to like get everybody to go to something or try to use it to build following, we don't have to fill up the video with all this gunk, you know, and so we can just get to the point and just say, here's how you do this one thing and get it done and then leave, you know, like there doesn't have to be a whole bunch of subscribe to here and follow me and do this other stuff. I mean, as a user, I find that to be annoying, you know, and so I just want to have the information. But I do think that having a YouTube channel, which as we launch the new YouTube channel, someone's got an open mic. I think it's powerful for us to have lots of little tidbits of little tricks that'll save you a bunch of time. And then, you know, at the end on a slate or something, you know, find out more in After Hours or something like that where people or Office Hours, just so people know where to go to ask more questions. But rather than trying to be totally comprehensive, is really give people what they mostly will need and then give them somewhere to go. Go ahead, Mitchell.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I also want to amplify what Mickey was saying. If you're saying use a TRS connector to plug your microphone into, doesn't necessarily describe how that is wired, because it could be different between a Sony, a Sennheiser, sound devices. And a lot of times the tips you get from after hours can solve those problems like that. It's more of an interactive thing than it is a documentation thing.
I do think that though there are knowledge that's percolating up through our system that I think it would be great to codify and just throw into both a blog as well as a video of things that we just know work, you know, and like, hey, this is gonna, you know, like I, when someone asks me, you know, to me, it's almost rote at this point. Someone asks me, okay, how do I prioritize what I make better on my home setup? And I said, internet, audio, lighting, camera, background, like in that order, you know, and I can just say that right off the top of my head, like that is the way, that's how you fix your internet. I mean, your how you look on Zoom. And those are the kind of things that we can, I think we can codify a little bit more. I will say again, to underline what was said before, is that it's more than just you'll get a more complete answer. It's that conversation builds community. Coming in and asking questions and being the person that asks the questions is important because somewhere down the road you'll be answering them. And there's kind of a virtuous cycle there that occurs when we come in and ask for help. So yeah, next question.
So JC Tours, who was here earlier from South Carolina, is back with, has anyone braved Windows 11? What are the current hookups? Same for the newest Mac OS update. I know each person uses different programs.
Go ahead, Jeffrey.
I'll speak on the PC side. I have a couple machines running Windows 11. My main machine is going to be doing it within the next week. First of all, you'll go through a compatibility checklist before you even start, and that'll tell you exactly what you need to do to make this Windows 11 work for you. With that said, there were some problems at the beginning that an update has pretty much fixed it. So make sure that you do the updates the second that you're done with Windows 11 upgrade, and then always have that backup plan just in case you do need to move back to Windows 10.
Go ahead, Jason.
I've opined more about Windows 11 than I found practical use for it in practice at this point. So decide what you want about that. On the Mac side, current version of Mac OS is pretty stable, you know, with only a few gotchas, and they are getting lesser and lesser by the day.
Go to Rupert.
Everybody knows I'm a Windows shop here. I've probably got a dozen Windows computers around me. I have been holding off on the Windows 11 update because Zoom had not yet officially supported it. And there were some anecdotal reports a few weeks back of some occasional problems, particularly with audio under Windows 11 in Zoom. So I didn't want to touch it for the time being. I just checked the documentation, and actually Windows 11 is now supported under the latest release of Zoom 5.9.0. So it just came out. So another reason to maybe at least look at moving forward with Windows 11.
Go, John.
So I've got both Windows 11 and Mac OS, the latest 12. And I haven't run into any real issues, although when I did upgrade to Windows 11, I lost all my customizations, all my shortcuts that were on my start menu, and I had to repin everything. Plus, the new start menu to me is a step backwards. It isn't really useful. So I had to install a utility that gave me back my Windows 10 view. Personally, unless you are on the cutting edge or have a need like I do for, you know, familiarizing myself with the next technology before it gets rolled out in my enterprise, I would stick with Windows 11. I don't see any real big urgent need to move forward right now, especially if you're in production. It's more stable, it's a known quantity, and that sort of thing. On Mac, I haven't run into any major issues, although I saw your tweet yesterday, Alex, with the orange dot thing, and I've noticed that I have that orange dot on non-active windows. If it's an active window, the orange dot isn't there. What that orange dot is there's a new microphone visualization, so when your mic is active, it's by an application. It shows an orange dot on the top right-hand corner of the screen. And that dot's present whether or not the menu is visible or anything else is visible. And it's there to show your microphone's active, which is a nice security tool. But if you're in a production, you don't want that.
Go ahead, Peter.
So a couple of things is I think John meant stay with Windows 10, not stay with Windows 11. But I use Mac everywhere, but the machine I'm talking to you right now is on 12.1, which is the latest public release of Mac OS, and it seems to be behaving fine once I got all the rogue amoeba software straightened out. because they had to do some things for their sound capture stuff. And I'm running 12.2 beta on my M1 Mac Mini, and it's working just fine as well.
I will say that I would not recommend going to Monterey. So in general, I find that Monterey is a mess. You know, like my iCal is like barely usable, you know, at the moment. Like ever since I upgraded, I have to wait literally like 10 seconds or 20 seconds to get my day. And then selecting actual calendar items, I sit there and click and then I wait. I could probably go get a coffee to see it, which makes jumping into Zoom really a pain. So those are things that's in addition to, you know, a variety of Dante issues, other app issues in Orange Dot. I got a lot more aggressive. Usually I'm a whole year behind. I mean, I just started upgrading to Big Sur. There was a couple apps that needed me to jump on Monterey, so I jumped on it, and I regret it. You know, so I would stick with, I think Big Sur is mature, but as a production person, I probably wouldn't put any new computers that I didn't have to on Monterey until next summer. Next question.
Stefan Fischer in Würzburg, Germany is up next. Every now and then, my Apple Magic Mouse cursor seems to be braked or delayed. Any ideas what causes that? It happens even after a restart or with no system pressure at all.
Tzolak.
I would suggest looking at charge. I mean, I think, is there a correlation with the batteries being at very low, and is it slowing down at that point? I suspect that sometimes that's the issue that you're running into.
Go ahead, Mitchell.
Yeah, unfortunately, if you're charging, you can't use a mouse because some engineer decided it was good to put the charging cable on the bottom. But for the most part, it's a wireless device. It's using Bluetooth, and there's all kinds of environmental issues that can interfere with the communication between your Mac and your Magic Mouse or your Magic Keyboard. So it usually is temporary and goes away. It seems to show up when things have been left alone for a while and you're not actively using it, and you come back to it after it's been asleep for a while. But it's just part of the thing with wireless devices.
Go ahead, Jason.
This was a known issue going back to the Mac Mini redesign, I believe in 2016. It was fixed, as far as I can tell, everything after, three versions ago? I'm blanking on the one before Big Sur. Long story short, if you have the oldest Magic Mouse, the one with the little battery compartment, replace it and then see if you still have a problem.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, on top of the power issue that Plalak mentioned and also the sleeping issue that Mitchell mentioned, you're using a Bluetooth radio. So if you are, say, connected to your Macintosh with your AirPods, that could be using the same Bluetooth chip. And your computer has to balance out which one it's talking to at the time. And on top of that, and I'm going to work the mic a little bit, Stefan, why are you using a Magic Mouse? Like, why are you doing this to yourself? We care for you.
Thank you very much.
Friends that was don't so dear. Let friends.
All right.
Next I'm question. Open for recommendations.
I gotta stop laughing before. Okay,
Logitech MX2. Sorry.
Tommy Shantz in St. Paul, Minnesota is back with, what are the necessary tools you need in place to switch 2.0? What do you need for monitoring audio and video during the meeting and or webinar?
Go ahead, Slalak.
So you need to be able to see your multi-view, and you need to be able to hear the meeting in real time. So you have to have enough monitors. And enough monitors to have your control panel, which is on Universe in a browser, as well as a Zoom meeting, as well as probably the training meeting as you start. So you need to have enough monitors in order to sort of line all that up and have it be super, super easy for you to look at and work with at any given point.
Next question.
Douglas Carmichael's up next, and Douglas says, how does the FSHDR create HDR from a non-HDR source?
I go, Jason.
I'll answer the question that is very clearly intended for Alex. First, it standardizes the frame rate and resolution, and then it uses a perceptual proprietary transformative control that I think Aja calls the color front engine. What makes this unique, I think unique, is that it uses knee slope and knee point adjustment instead of your standard like sliders.
Yeah, and basically the conversion from 709, Rec 709, which is what we're mostly working inside of, to a PQ or an HDR 10 curve is relatively known. So it's making those adjustments. The big thing that we're getting is a lot of sliders to control it. So what you're looking at on YouTube is not a straight conversion from 709, Rec 709 to HDR 10. I'm making a bunch of adjustments inside of the FSHDR, which I have control over everything from lift to gamma to gain to color to intensity. So there's a lot of controls I have within the color front engine to make adjustments to get the most out of it. And I think we're getting pretty close. I mean, we're not getting everything we could, but it looks pretty good. So it's starting to really snap. But that's partially it's partially a lot of work done by the panelists to get their stuff, their sources in a good place for this. But a lot of it also is in that color front engine. But there is a standard 709, Rec 709 to PQ or HDR 10 conversion. And then I'm tweaking and pulling, as Jason referred to, knees and gammas and so on and so forth around to try to get the most out of each image. And we're hoping sometime in the spring we'll be able to do that to each person, which will be kind of fun. Next question.
Jason Panks in Nashville, Tennessee, up next with using Switcher Studio on an M1 iPad Pro. Suggestions for iPad dock with HDMI, Ethernet, USB-A, and power.
I haven't really used a lot of iPad docks, so I'm not totally familiar with what we could and couldn't use. I think, will any power dock work with an iPad? I mean, as far as showing them there? Go ahead, Jason.
The OWC one is fully class compliant. The cheapest one they have works beautifully.
There you go. Jeffrey?
The other end is that Switcher Studio has not made any comment as to what type of dock to use, so they might not support it at all.
Right. Go ahead, Sky.
I believe I used a daisy chain of different dongles on my last iPad experience, including one of them had to be the Ethernet. So, just the Apple components.
Next question.
Tony Mobley's back from Noonan, Georgia with this one. Is it time to officially turn off YouTube chat for conversations with Tony Mobley based on yesterday's activity?
Go ahead, Tony.
So the reason I asked the question is because it was problematic for me that we were having those kinds of issues. But at the same time, it's an issue for people who are not office hour members to be able to get into the questions and the chat. And so I really asked the question because I want to hear what the community thinks about it.
Go ahead, Lala.
So as the show has moved along, we've had less questions coming through in YouTube. That doesn't mean that there needs to be, that we need to turn it off and lose that potential for those questions to come in there. I think the first step we do is we put into place monitors, which we did not have. So we're going to have Laura will be a monitor, and hopefully some others will volunteer to be monitors. And then at some point when we feel like really all the questions are coming through on Mukana, particularly when we have people who are not office hours members on the panel, then we can turn that off. That's my opinion, but that's only opinion.
Go, Jonas.
I would not turn it off. I would maybe enable a slow boat and enable that followers only can ride. And then I would put in a bot that broadcasts, hey, want to connect with Tony? Have a question about the current conversation? Go to this link. And what might be beneficial for Mukana if there would be like a small form just where you can submit a question without being exposed to the whole interface. So you could be like, I just want to put in a question right now. That's the easiest way to do it instead of like suddenly you have two YouTube sources playing and there's this whole thing of logging in. Maybe that would be a better solve, but putting in a broadcast message probably would solve 90% of the issues.
Go ahead, Sky.
I'm kind of curious about how can the problem be your solution, and to listen to Tlaloc is putting a body in that location is the engagement that you want. And Tony, because you're still at early days, my gut says I vote against shutting any way for people to connect with you, but to put somebody in that that door as a way of recepting, being a receptionist or a receptionist person, that has a lot of the engagement conversation that we were hearing earlier about. How would we interact with humans? Should we just put out a video, or should we have somebody there to shake their hand and help them? So my vote's to, at this stage, use the human power, human resources, because then the bots will always take over.
Given that you're doing something regular, I've done over 1,000 events on YouTube. The comments are worthless. Like, they're just worthless. As soon as you become popular, they'll get worse, way worse. Like, all that's going to happen is that as soon as you start to be, when you're not successful, you're barely getting any questions. You have plenty coming through on, most likely on it, you know, like push people towards the platform that you want them to ask the questions. As soon as you turn a corner and start becoming popular, there is a, you know, it's like a Balrog that comes out of you know, like just this ugly mess that will come out of YouTube that just squeezes out of it in this ugly acid. And so, you know, we just generally turn on, the only reason we have comments on in YouTube for this is because Zoom automatically turns them on. But when I build an event, I build it and turn the comments off. Like, I just turn it off. And I did that because all of our brands, every brand we worked with, finally got to a point where they were like, this isn't worth it. You know, and so the it's not just the comments. It's the fact that having comments intermingled with questions makes it highly inefficient. And just and the reason you need low latency is because your questions are being merged with the comments, and you want to be able to separate those things out. And so I would highly recommend, we're going to probably move Mukana to be phone only, because that allows us to really tighten all the bolts. But you're better off having people who are committed coming over and over again to be the only ones that I can ask questions. First people coming in when they first arrive don't really matter. Like, I, you know, just to be clear, like they that's not who you're trying to attract. What you're trying to attract is people who come over and over and over again, you know. And if you're only doing a one-off, that's a whole different math. But when you're doing it over and over again, what you want is to build up community and have the people who are coming over and over again have your ear and have the other folks earn their way into that process. Next question.
Jonas Dattel in Stuttgart, who is just on speaking, says, should we put a music bot into After Hours during the holiday, both as a host keeper and to fill the silence?
Go ahead, Jonas.
Yeah, we had some tests with it, and the cool thing, since to mute a silent or low audio automatically when more than three people are speaking, was that it almost never was an issue. And if we put Zoom OSC on it, then any host or co-host can mute, ask to unmute and mute. And that way we could have a way to have some music when it's silent.
Go ahead, Mitchell.
Jonas, that's a very interesting question, because one of the things that I do in my business is I provide background branded music for retail locations around the world. And wouldn't it be cool to have an after hours radio that could change depending on the season, and also be able to play back? There's lots of devices out there that can play automatically curated playlists, like Sam Broadcaster, Simeon, iMedia Touch. There's a bunch of different programs out there. The only thing we'd have to tackle if we did that would be the music licensing requirements as Sound Exchange and BMI ASCAP and CSAC would dictate. So I think it's a cool idea. I think it might be an interesting thing to have Alex's favorite playlist play at a off-hour time, then we could hear what Alex is into.
I don't think anyone would want to hear my playlist. You know, it's
better than quiet.
Yeah, it might be. Jeffrey?
I don't know. The whole idea that music ducks out and then ducks back in could be more of a distraction on anything. What I'd like to see is if we can actually work on building it so it turns into an actual jukebox where somebody can say, play this song, and it plays that. I think that would be a more worthwhile experiment inside of After Hours.
Yeah, go ahead, Courtney.
Yeah, I kind of agree with Jeffrey. A lot of times I'll turn it on, and if there's silence, I'll just leave it on in the background. And then when I hear somebody talking, it'll draw my attention to that channel, and I can come and listen or participate. And if there's something playing all the time, that'll be harder to divine whether somebody's active or it's just gone into the bot in the background. And also, if it's playing music, I may want to have my own music on in the background, and it'll clash with that while I'm waiting for someone to come on and get into a discussion in After Hours.
Go ahead, Sky.
I love the idea, but you will need to point the camera at a Yule log, burning, of course, because you have to.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I have the same experience as Courtney. I keep after hours open in the background. But if there's always something playing there, I'd have to shut it because of what I do for work. I need it.
Yeah. Bill?
I was just going to really quickly note, after these 3 months of Christmas music relentlessly, I would just vote for an all Wagner channel or something like that.
Yeah, I think that I'm happy to experiment with it, especially in the next couple of days if people want to do it. I think that I lean towards Courtney and Mickey, which is that I tend to leave it on. And if it was playing all the time, I would turn it off and then I wouldn't hear people talking, you know, because I would just, you know, I would immediately turn off. I'm super picky about, no one wants to listen to my playlist, but my playlist is very, I'm very picky about, and I'm usually into something very specific. And so something random would probably be difficult for me to manage. I do know that if it plays underneath, we did try that one day. It makes me absolutely insane almost immediately. Like it turns on a whole lower brain problem for me. I don't know what it is, but it's just talking over the music. I don't go to bars that have bands, you know, like, or music. Like I tend to like to be in conversation. So I'd be happy to experiment with it. We could have Saturday nights or Friday nights or whatever. And I could be wrong. Like, you know, like I'm clear that, and I'm totally open to experimentation. I don't think we should do it all the time, but maybe over weekends or over Saturday nights or Friday nights or whatever, we play with the idea and see if we find some happy medium. Or maybe there's eventually a breakout room that people can go listen to it. But I do think that the problem is, I think the behavior would be a lot of people would turn it off because it conflicted with whatever else they were doing. I think when it's silent, it's good to just leave it off, because then people hear, you hear people like coming up for air when they need it. Next question.
Christian Pryor, it looks like Mamulan, I hope I'm getting that right, in Wolfsburg, Germany, says it seems the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema cameras are preferred over the Blackmagic Studio cameras, even for studio live stream use cases. What makes the Pocket Cinema line so much more popular?
I'll go with TJ.
I'd say for here, there's two reasons. One, control. The Blackmagic Studio cameras are controlled over SDI, and us here with our A10 Minis and A10 Mini Pros, those all work over HDMI, so the Pocket Cinema cameras work better that way. And secondly would be the larger sensor in the Pocket Cinema cameras. It gathers more light, so it has better light collecting ability, better noise, and gives you better depth of field when you're looking for that cinematic look.
Go ahead, Jason.
Everything that TJ said, absolutely. What I would add to that would be the XLRs, and the versatility of being able to just pick it up and use it for other things. Also, a lot of us have Canon lenses that, you know, we're not using at any given time.
Yeah, and Sky?
I chose the Pocket Cinemas because I was needing to take these into the field. I was doing feature films and documentaries, so I like the flexibility that I could put it into a cage, throw it into a bag, and run and go.
Yeah, I really think one of the big things is you buy that camera and you have something that you can take out and shoot, as what Sky was outlining, and then you also can actually use it in studio, and also that it's Super 35 for the 6K. So next question.
Next one comes from Tony Mobley, our friend in Noonan, Georgia, and he says, what is Tlaloc's setup at the hotel?
Tlaloc?
Well, I looked at the room and I figured out where I could put stuff, and I started moving desks and shoving tables around and using tables as tripods, just how I kind of am. So I have a little bit of a picture. I have a lot of stuff stacked up on itself, and it's a 6K with a Blue Yeti microphone and a hotel room, and I unplugged the refrigerator. Important note.
It's funny. It is funny when you show up at something and you I do the same thing. I'm moving the desks and everything else around when I get there. I replace the lights. I've started taking the light fixtures in, and so it is a funny thing. Go ahead, Rupert, and then we'll move on.
And a tip I recently saw somebody do is use the ironing board as a standing desk.
Next question. We're going to do this real quick.
Eduardo Augustine in Panama says, as a small group production, how can I stream to studio so that afterwards the studio stream to the desired platform? RTMP server, or is there another solution?
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I'd probably look at hardware solutions. Try to stream SRT if you can. It's more reliable, just generally speaking, than RTMP. Look at solutions from LiveView, and also Teradek has some stuff. Also, KiloView and Matrox are companies to look at.
Go ahead, Jeffrey, real quick.
So Guy has been doing some SRT tests in after hours. You can always join and play with that with us.
All right. We're going to change subjects and jump into the second hour. This whole Belfast method started with Richard reaching out to me a couple times, like, hey, I felt like Richard was like the guy from the Avengers that keeps on walking up going, you're going to want to talk to me. You know, like, I need to talk to you. You know, like it was over a couple months where Richard was like, hey, I've got an idea. And I finally got my attention. You know, we were just going through so much stuff. And then as soon as Richard outlined what he was doing, I was like, oh, we have to do this. Like, we just have to get this started. It was such a great opportunity to be part of a theater and give us an opportunity to figure this stuff out. And so we started experimenting. And now we have what has now been even on NPR as the Belfast Method. And I, from here, I'm going to let Richard kind of take over the story.
Oh, thanks, Alex. I'm not too sure if I'm Agent Coulson or Samuel L. Jackson in that one. I'm not too sure. I'm definitely not Nick Fury. That's for sure. So the Belfast Method. So what the heck is this thing that we've been doing? And to answer Alex's question, I think Alex in Mukana's question earlier on, whenever we started this whole thing, there was a slightly different aim than what it's grown into. Thankfully, because of all the different fantastic people who have joined us to get involved and to play around and to experiment, it's allowed it to grow into something much more interesting. So in my mind, it's become this kind of global REMI thing. And I kind of a love-hate relationship with that term. And I kind of promised Mickey and Brian I wouldn't use it, but in the end, I decided to do it. So the global REMI. So REMI is a remote integration model, REMI. And global REMI, in my mind, is the ability for us to have a lot of people all around the world, just as Tlaloc said, a distributed team all around the world be able to connect to a remote control center and then do a lot of interesting things. So originally it was started to establish like a collaborative training system. So we talk about a lot of fantastic things in office hours and after hours, and sometimes we talk in hypotheticals more than we can in practicals. So I thought, well, there's this whole system that I've started to build for our theater where we're still learning a lot of what we're doing. And as we're still learning it, I thought others can learn with us and test out and show us how to use what we have much better and at the same time learn together. It grew very quickly into what is now become to develop the collaborative production model for small venues to reach global audiences, mainly because we've created such a really interesting robust system that I've now been able to reach out to other venues of a similar scale to ours, which are small 100 seaters, smaller, and start to say, hey, you've bought equipment over the pandemic. Many different arts councils and groups around were opened the doors to online investment where previously it was being closed, now, you know, what can you do with it? You know, it's not just going to sit in a cupboard once you reopen. Let's do something interesting and, you know, have teams much, much more widely be able to kind of come in and work with you and develop things. So that's kind of where we're sort of at, where we weekly perform a test production every Saturday on the long days. And we've grown it well beyond that. So we started on the 21st of August, and since then we've done 11 different productions on the Saturdays. We've actually done even more than that because the team who are involved on the Saturdays have now gotten in to being involved on some of the accidental shows. So we've done about another further 10 to 12 different productions. We have all these different countries on a regular basis connecting in to my little country in Northern Ireland. This map is not to scale. Northern Ireland is not the hub of the world. So I'm going to talk today in a bit of a breakdown about an example project. So this is one that we did a couple of weeks back before Super Saturday and before the most recent shows. And it's a nice kind of in-between point because we started in one place and now we're in a completely different one. And this one is a nice little example. So on that day, we had Brian, Sky, and Ari calling the show. We had Brian, Emma, who's on my team local, and Graham and Ari switching the show. We had Douglas and Matt doing sound operation, and we had Graham, JJ, and Dennis doing camera control for the PTZs remotely, and we had Tlaloc on the lighting. So it's a good kind of example of just how distributed this team is and all how kind of connected into lots of different layers they are. So it's quite a nice little example. So what do we do and how do we start and what solutions have we used? So as standardly, we use at the beginning, kind of remote desktop control. We started with AnyDesk. We then also started to use Parsec. We also mostly started with using VPNs, L2 TTP VPNs. And now we use a lot of Universe. So we kind of use each of these things in slightly different ways. So at the moment, we still use the VPNs for audio control for the X32s. But for camera control and for switching, we use Universe. And I'll talk a lot more about that in a little second. So this is our standard kind of multi-view for the method. We have three PTZ cameras. We have then three IRSA cameras. We have our graphics, and then we obviously have our super sources we want. And as you can see there, we have a couple of different people controlling each camera, each PTZ. The IRSAs, we haven't added individual people controlling because they're mostly in fixed positions at the moment. And then we have graphics, which also becomes part of the interface. Pardon me. You can see there we've got multiple cameras moving at the same time, which is the real benefit of being able to have a remote team controlling these things, because it's not something that we can do. We've got a controller in the theater, but we can only control one camera at a time. But now we have the ability to have all three cameras moving and changing and being updated in real time, really quickly, really smoothly through Universe Control. It's worth noting at the beginning, we didn't think we'd ever get to PTZ camera control. Brian, who's going to talk a little bit later, first kind of managed to kind of get in a version of PTZ camera control through Companion, and he'll kind of take you through some of that a little bit later. But we thought at the beginning it might be a really pie in the sky thing that we get really later on, but we got much, much earlier, thanks to Universe. So from the breakdowns I've done before, I've kind of often give kit lists. So this is kind of some of the things that we've been playing with. This is what's up in the theater. So this is what's above me at the moment. It kind of lays out a little bit like this, where we have the different lights over the stage section there. We've got two really big TVs, which normally have Mukana on it for the artist to see, the teleprompter view of Mukana. We have our three PTZs. So as you can see, the three PTZs, there's two at the front over by one of the main doors and one to the side. And then on top of that, we have the three IRSAs. So the PTZs are in fixed positions, but the IRSAs are designed with wireless kits that can move around the room to give us a lot more variety of shots. And the wireless kits have given us some good times and some bad times. There's also then the X32 in the sound booth, as well as then a couple of the other kind of hubs that connect the PTZs to the network, as well as the lighting network as well. So in the main control room where I am at the moment, this is all the different things that we connect to, and that kind of looks like this. So we have around about six camera feeds coming down from the theater into the main system. We have feeds coming from multiple different computers, and then because of the method for us to connect to the officers, we have a lot of feeds going back out. So if I take away the audio, first of all, from this, we have six camera feeds, as I said, then we have five feeds going back out to computers. We have two feeds going out to HyperText, and we have one feed going out to YouTube as a standard. We don't often run a backup for the Belfast method at the moment. So one of the things that is quite challenging, and I haven't really gone through this kind of level of detail before, but what's quite challenging is getting enough feeds out to enough people to see enough things. So we have multi-views, we have program feed that goes out to the crew, then we have a program feed that goes out to office hours, and then we have a special feed that goes to the audio room where the audio engineer can change what's going to that feed. And this is only video when I'm describing this, because we have an audio feed as well, specially for the mixer. And then we have another multi-view that goes out to the office hours. We often just have three computers dedicated to each of the PTZs for PTC operators. I'm calling it PTC like I'm an American. PTZ, sorry, apologies. Then we have, and they still have the special audio room, and then we have a multi-view which has no audio, which goes to the crew because all of the audio is done through comms. The reason we can do a lot of this is because we have a smart hub, and the smart hub is absolutely fantastic. It was, an amazing purchase to do from our perspective, because we can take all these different inputs on the left-hand side and send them anywhere we want within that chain. It's really a fantastic and allows us to do a lot of things on the fly. So I've never gone into the networking kind of side of things because I'm not a network engineer, but I'll give you an overview of what we do. So networking wise, these are the kind of standard pieces of kit that we have. The netgear at the end is a separate, mostly run to give data and power to the PTZs, and then Dante is a completely separate system. So that kind of looks like this in terms of how the building is laid out. Most of the things are designed for running for the theater itself, but we have the control room, which has a fiber connection between the first floor where the main internet comes into the building, and then everything else is down in the control room and mostly. So it lays out something like this. So we have the main USG comes into the main switch, and the main switch then sends everything to everywhere else. And most of the things, all the item system has its own switch. So everything is connected through that. And then the computers have their own separate switch as well. And then the PTZs have a special net gear, which also connects the control for the X32 as well and for the lights. And then the Clearcaster, as you can see in orange there, has its own direct connection back up to the main switch to get it out of the building as quickly as possible. We don't often worry in the terms of the method with most of that kit. These are the things that we mostly focus on: controlling the ATEM, controlling the X32, controlling the PTZs, and controlling one or two computers. And that's mostly for lighting control, which we'll come to in a little second. So when we first started, we did 5 to 6 LT2P VPNs, and they were controlling the X32 edit on computers that were remote, controlling the X32 console, and then software control for ATEM software control on people's computers, again, controlling the ATEM. There were some limitations to this. The ATEM can only allow a certain number of simultaneous connections, I think around about 4 to 5. But sometimes we find that's even lower. One of those connections would be taken up by our advanced panel here in Belfast. That is our main backup. And then the other connections, sometimes there'd be another software control run here for us to do keying and things like that. So that often leads only 2 or 3 connections for others to connect into, which was quite limiting. And sometimes it didn't quite connect. So we had problems with people connecting to our VPN on PCs. We had people have trouble connecting on iPads for mixed effect and so forth. So it was a little bit tricky, and it has obviously other drawbacks that exposes our entire system to the internet. There are certain security things we've put in place. We've also added on then direct control for a parsec. So on one of the Mac Minis, we have our lighting control running, and then Tlaloc can remote in and control that. And then on another computer, we have parsec running for Mickey to dial in and change routing via Dante controller and so forth as well. So it gives a little bit extra layer of control. Then when we started to add in universe control, and I will give at this stage a massive shout out to Manolo, who's not able to join us today, but Manolo has done all the hard work on the universe side. He has a special site-to-site connection to us, so because we don't have a PC in the building. Until today, it arrived today during the first part of office hours, so now we have a PC. The first PC I've ever bought since I was 15. It's quite a day. It's all run through Universe that's connected. Everyone connects to Manolo, and the Manolo connects to us via site-to-site. And then that's kind of now allowed a lot more control. So we can control, again, now the PTZs. We can control the ATEM. The ATEM also Universe can control QLab if we want to on a computer in our building. So it's all done through different things: direct control from Universe or connecting into ATEM OSC, also via Universe as well. So with Universe, it allowed us to do some of these little interesting things. So this is Manolo's, I think, 36th version of Universe that he told me this week. So this is some of the different kind of panels that he's been looking at. This is looking at edit mode. So this is the PTZ version. And then we have the switcher version in a couple of different modes. And then he also has an entire super source version, which allows us to, on the fly, choose what goes into each super source in each box and enable and disable things. And then the PTZ control system as well. And there's a whole load of different versions. And the team, Dennis and Brian, have done a huge amount of work with Manolo to test and retest and test again all the different things that come into it. So Universe will hopefully convince Manolo to do a whole second hour on Universe, his implementation of Universe for us at a later date in the new year.
As soon as he's available. No, that'd be amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought you'd be in, but it's getting Manolo. but yes.
Manolo, come on, do it.
He'll probably love it. So I'm looking forward to that. Because it's worth an entire section of its own to do. So just briefly in the audio, and Mickey will answer kind of questions in this in the Q&A afterwards, but this is kind of then how the audio chain works. We've got the X32 going out to Dante, the Dante switch also goes out to the in-ear monitors, and then that connects through via, again, Dante different AVIO devices into our audio delay box, into the ATEM, but also into the AVIOs for the Mac Minis, and also Dante DVS for the computers itself as well. And then they all feed audio back in to the X32 if they need to, if we can move comms and things around the place as well. So at this stage, I'm going to pass on to Lalok, who's going to just do a little brief intro into the how the lighting control kind of works. So to Lalok.
Oh, just out of curiosity, should I connect up? Because I feel like maybe it'll adjust your lighting, and I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
It's a good thing. I can always readjust my lighting. It's okay.
Okay.
Hopefully, my yellow has already killed the HDR feed. So we'll see what happens with you changing the lighting as well.
I wasn't going to bring it up, but yeah, I had to turn my screen down because I was like, oh, we're going to have burn-in. so anyway.
I adjusted it pre-show when I looked at my mic check. So this is even lower than it was at the pre-show.
Yeah, it's more the slide. But anyway, it's fine. It's all good. Go ahead, Talalik.
There we go. So I got to make sure I'm on the right thing. You guys can see this monitor. I am not able to parsec in today because of firewalls at the hotel. So I anydesked in. And we worked early on using AnyDesk, but it was really laggy, so I may run into that today. But we're using the EOS platform, and it's on site, so it's controlling lighting there, and I have control of each of the lights. One of the things that I found in the space is that's a little difficult is it's actually smaller than it seems with all of the vision mixing that we do. And so we have a little bleed over on some of the performers and things like that. So, but I'm going to just control all the lights first. And as you can see, I've made things happen. And apparently flash, which might be because we're connected to two control systems at the same time right now. We'll stop that. I went in and made cues, and I made a variety of different cues, and I would just sort of try to sort of easefully go between different cues so that it has some semblance of a feel with the music that's playing. And I have color control. I don't know what we're looking at here, Richard, in terms of the theater, but I can control the background lights. I can control the color of them. Let's see, make them full. And I can adjust their intensity, and I can adjust they also have a zoom that I can control. And then we also have the little LED curtain wall in the background that you've noticed in some of the shots. We were able to get minimal control of that, although it's tricky. I'd like to have way more control of that, but you know, everything is like to have. But that's how we did it. I'm gonna turn this off so Richard can look right again.
I don't know if that's possible, but I will bring my light back up just so that you have some light on me at least. Getting flashing. Going to strobe it for the rest of the show.
There you go. It should be good now.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to also then hand over to Brian, who's going to have a wee chat about his experience, and I'm going to go over to, this is one of Brian's slides. So Brian joined us in October. He'll tell you the exact date as it's burned into his memory. He had never touched any of this stuff before and started brand new to never heard the word item before kind of stage. So Brian.
Thanks, Richard. So I am a remote operator for Accidental Theatre. And when I first started back in October, 3rd of October this year, we were using the VPN connection. So I was able to remote into the 2ME switcher in Ireland from my laptop in Australia using the ATEM software control as the interface. And as we saw before with the multi-view, the multi-view from the ATEM is displayed in the Zoom window that I can see. And then I communicate with a remote production team who are coming in from all over the world via the Unity app on my phone. And what's remarkable about all of this is not that I live over 10,000 miles from Belfast, but that my upload speed is 14 megabits and it's able to keep up with it. So like most of you, I started off by watching Office Hours on YouTube, and I kept hearing about the Belfast method. And I reached out to Richard on Discord and I asked if I can have a go at switching. And of course he said, yes, come along. And I had such a great time that the very next day I went out and I bought a Stream Deck and I learned Companion from Rotem. So I wanted to explore what I could do with Companion. So I started creating pages for switching, then SuperSource, and eventually the PTZ control, which was obviously a whole new thing for remote production in Accidental, as Richard said. And we'd only been controlling the switcher remotely prior to then. So there was a small group of us who were working behind the scenes to see what we could do with remote control of PTZs. And a PTZ, for anyone who doesn't know, is pan, tilt, zoom cameras. So working with Dennis and Manolo, we tried a few different approaches, including Panasonic's own webpage app, which was not very successful and not very useful. And then, of course, Manolo created the Universe webpages, and everything improved after this. So the next slide is showing how we replaced the VPN connection with Universe. So remote operators are now able to directly control the ATEM and the PTZ cameras via the web browser with Universe stages, rather than just having to use the Stream Deck and the ATEM software control. So all you need now is a stable internet connection, and I can call a show even just with a Unity app on my phone and a Zoom window as well. So it's fairly incredible to be able to do that. But having Universe allows the operators better access and greater control to be able to dial in the PTZ movements at a more granular level. And this gives us a whole new way of working, and it's really improved the quality of the productions. So even as a technical director calling a show, you have more freedom and a larger palette to work with because there's more variety of shots that you can call on. So since starting in October, I've been involved in 15 shows now with Accidental, where I've had roles as switcher, PTZ operator, show caller, and camera shader. And we once did the headless camera shading. So now I'm also helping on board others as remote operators for Accidental. I've also worked with Todd Reynolds as a graphic designer, technical director, and production assistant. And I've worked as an executive producer and technical director on Conversations with Tony Mobley. And I was also a switcher for the cooking show on Super Saturday, where I was cutting between four different ATEMs using a universal page that Jonas had created. And before joining Office Hours 3 months ago, I had no prior experience in media production. So I'm very grateful to Richard and for the opportunities I've had so far. And I've definitely learned a lot.
That's awesome. Thanks, Brian. Do you want to show them the PTZ control?
Yeah, sure. So I'll just screen share for a moment. That's okay. I can't do that.
Sky just needs to give you co-host.
Yeah, I'll let you get. I'll be right there.
And Tlaloc, do you want to dial back into the lighting?
Okay, so this is the PTZ panel that the remote controller or the remote operator would use. And what's great about this is that each of these buttons represent different fine-grained controls in terms of being able to control zoom speed, pan tilt as well. So in the middle, we've got our PTZ pad. So you've got pan, and then you've got tilt, and then you can also go obviously diagonally as well. What's great about this though, and what Manolo has been able to refine, is that we can single tap or double tap, triple tap, and that actually controls the speed, speeding it up further so that you're getting a quicker pan. We can also go into a granular zoom by going into your tele sort of plus five, and the more times that you click that, the faster the zoom goes. There's also quick zoom as well, so that you can actually really ramp up the zoom. Up the top, we've got the presets, and that allows us to actually store a position that we move to on the cameras, and then we can actually call those presets back down the bottom. What Manolo's added recently is the ability to be able to have preset speed. So when we're calling back those presets, we can call them back quite fast or quite slow, depending on the type and the mood that we're going for. So if it's off camera and we're just wanting to recall a preset very quickly, we can do that. But if we're actually on camera, we can actually control that speed to a nice slow pace. On the left-hand side, we've got our different focus and iris and gain settings as well. And from this panel, you can actually go between all of the different PDZs. So that allows that really fine-grained granular control that I was talking about. And I mean, it's a testament to Manolo that he's got to this point where it's just amazing as a remote operator that we've been able to get this level of control. And it definitely moves way, way beyond what you can do with a Stream Deck.
That's awesome, Brian. My camera's up as well for in the theater if you want to move that around and until I lock in the lights, if you want to dial us out.
Great. So I'll just take you through a few presets.
Brian is right now in Australia, and he is controlling a camera in Northern Ireland. And Tulok is in the US and controlling the lights in the same theatre. It's still quite marvellous.
It's great.
Awesome. Thanks, Brian.
Thanks a lot.
Is there anything next? We can't hear
me,
you, Richard.
Me trying to get my lights back on is okay. Next.
Excellent.
Thanks, Tulok. Do you want to dial out if you haven't already? There we go. Stabilized. That's brilliant. So that's kind of a rough overview of what we've been doing, how we're connecting in together, and what we've kind of gone through very briefly. The technical PDF for this presentation I'll stick onto Discord later on, so you don't have to try and remember everything and all the different connections. That's us.
Let's jump into the questions.
Absolutely. First one on here comes from Douglas Carmichael, who asks, many live experiences like the Kings of Leon non-fungible token include backstage access and observing the technical processes involved, the sound check and so forth. Could that observation translate into a virtual environment considering the success of the Belfast method?
All of these things can benefit from it. I think what we're seeing is the beginning of something that, you know, doesn't have a full shape yet, but we're slowly, you know, piecing together. It solves a real problem. I mean, I think that we talk about being able to do events in one location, being able to do events in the cloud, but the reality is there's still things that need to be controlled in, you know, on the ground. And we've really solved a lot of, or this team has solved a lot of those issues. And I think that it can definitely be advantageous for a lot of folks. Go ahead, Tulok.
Douglas has asked this question before in a different way, and now I finally understand it. We can maybe make a niche behind the scenes experience for people that it would be easier to give to people. And I hadn't thought of it quite that way before. That's kind of cool.
Yeah. I think that there is, I mean, I get the opportunity every once in a while to watch some behind the scenes of broadcasts, and I think there's a whole business there because it's so fascinating. Sometimes I find that to be more interesting than the actual show. In fact, most of the time I do. Next question.
Ray Harwood in Avondale, Arizona says, think about tomorrow's second hour and how a small solo producer can leverage a smaller level of assistance as needed. Is there an opportunity in that space for the Belfast Light?
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I definitely think this kind of workflow can be scaled both up and down. Even, you know, if it's just controlling someone's vMix system, it could be done even via Parsec if we want to go that route. So there are many ways to do things with this remote crewing workflow.
And go ahead, Jonas.
It's not only about how many people you can work with, it's also about how efficient you can use your time. Also in the day of today where we have issues with COVID exposure, I was not allowed to go into church, for example, to control it. All I needed to do is plug in a Raspberry Pi that was tunneling out the ports for the ATEM and for our audio desk, and I could remote control it alone from home. And yeah, from home I can control remote systems way better because I have way more set up. I have X Touch, I have multiple stream decks, and I think there's big value in providing those production services remote, and there probably will be an industry of people that fly in, set everything up, add the tech on site, but then you can get amazing producers for 2 hours, like a great TD, great audio person for 2 hours, and produce a better product for the client that you couldn't have produced before.
Go ahead, Sky.
I just wanted to continue to affirm, Richard, for the presentation that you just gave. I've often been hanging on to the mast of the ship, but I had no idea of all of the people that were pushing the buttons and making things happen and the switches that were connected. And to have that presentation very clearly, I'm speaking into the question is, can this method be used? Absolutely. And because you've done the blueprint and talked about the heritage of the past and then modifying quickly, and then Brian jumping in talking about the time frame of, I don't know what your history is as a creative, Brian, but you are using these hardware and software tools to do emotional and intellectual moving the hearts and moving the minds of humans. And so can this continue to be modified? Absolutely. But again, Richard, I just, before we get too far away, just a huge thank you for that presentation. Awesome.
Go ahead, Richard.
Thanks very much, Sky. And I think what's quite interesting, all the way through in terms of scalability, it's been in my head to understand how it can scale both large and small. We're a really small theater. We have a small team, and we have the ability within the projects that we do that we can scale all the way back down to one person if we need to, as well as scale up to a large large remote team. I think the inherent system that we've tried to use can scale, just as Mickey said, in either direction. And I think it's the benefit of throwing a lot of people at it in our way, using the volunteers that we've had, the fantastic time that they've put into it, is we get to build it more and more robust. So it is easier to scale out and give out to smaller teams in lots of ways once we have gone through all the different pain points. You know, even a couple of weeks back where we one of the buttons on Universe crashed Universe each time it was pressed because there was a conflict in the signal. Little things like that just help us take it further each time. And the Saturdays are essentially designed to just keep punching at the system until it is as robust as we can make it.
Yeah, and I think that's the real opportunity right now, is really pounding on it and just figuring it out. And we're seeing it from different angles, whether it's the Mobley process or the Belfast method or OH2. You know, all of these things are looking at the same problem from different directions. Next question.
Richard just mentioned the staff at the Belfast Theater, and Rupert McRae actually has a question about that. What have the opinions been from the Accidental Theater staff about the Belfast method?
Go ahead, Richard.
Well, we're Northern Irish. We don't often talk about our opinions very often. We just keep it to ourselves and passively aggressive take it out. The team is usually involved in each of the Saturday projects in different ways. So Emma, as you mentioned, as I was mentioning on the slides, has been part of the project from the beginning. Martin, who's our A1 on site, has been part of nearly all of the different shows, except for times where I've asked him to step off so he can find other ways of doing the same stuff, or where there's a conflict, because he's a musician in his own right. So they're usually they're very excited about being involved. The scalability of it, the excitement of being able to work and with a team that's all around the world. Again, it's one of those small country kind of syndromes. Is that, you know, we feel often very isolated. We're a small island in the middle of the Atlantic or the North Sea, depending which way you think about it. And you know, we're able to talk and develop and to meet a very large team. It's been an exciting process. The front of house staff haven't got a clue what's happening, but that's a different thing.
Next question.
Rupert McRae in Dallas, Texas, up next. He says, could the hardware needed on-site be standardized into a deployable package so that the venues could buy into the Belfast method in total alignment to the model?
Go ahead, Rupert.
I wanted to just add a little bit of context to the question. In the early days of this, before I think Belfast Method even had the name Belfast Method, I was talking to a venue up the street here who had done a good job of trying to buy equipment during lockdown, but that now didn't really know what to do with it. I've been holding off, you know, talking to them a little further because I've seen this method evolving and just sort of waiting for the point where it's suitable to pick up that conversation. So I'm just trying to figure out whether, you know, venues would need to adapt their hardware to suit this model. Having said that, I think there's a fantastic opportunity here for venues to collaborate too. You know, you do a show there and I bring it into this venue here, or just things like that.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, I think you can definitely standardize on, I guess, a package of equipment, but I don't see a real need for it because a lot of hardware have means of controlling them via IP. Like even back in March or April this year, Todd and I were playing around with me controlling his ATEM via, I think it was just, what were we doing? A light VPN, like Hamachi, I think we were trying out.
Yeah, it was just port forwarding.
Yeah, just port forwarding. So things, as I mentioned earlier, things can definitely scale. But if you want to standardize on something just to simplify deployment, then yeah, I guess you can do that.
Go ahead, Marty.
Yeah, with all the different feeds that need to go to different places, both video and audio and comms, there seems to me to be a set system that needs to be in place. And this is all real interesting because I've been talking with a whole bunch of venues here in the DC area about the value of web streaming, and especially considering the uncertainties about being able to bring people into the venue or not, depending on the COVID level restrictions and the uncertainty of what's going to happen in the future with, you know, other potential disruptions.
Jonas?
I would say yes, there definitely is a package that you could standardize on, but that package wouldn't include the AV equipment. Like Mickey said, most equipment is now IP controllable. What I think would be worth it building a package that allows remote control might be like a little PC with Universe, a VPN, sending that package out maybe with a cotton server, maybe with a way to like send feeds with an SAT encoder or something. But that's one of the amazing things with the Belfast project and how we're using the universe. It abstracts the whole hardware. For audio, it's still not fully there. It's still really native with XEdit. But for the ATEM, no. I guess we could change to vMix on the new Windows PC that Richard has and nobody would notice because it would look the same. The interface wouldn't change. We would just change in the background if it sends to the ATEM or if it sends to vMix. So in that case, you don't need to standardize that part, but it might be worth it building a standard or even a protocol for remote control.
Go ahead, Richard.
I think my heart would notice, Jonas. I would agree with definitely both points, but my preference at the moment for what we're still experimenting down is to talk to the venues and start to understand what their need is and start to understand how to control their systems without even asking them to buy or to purchase anything at this stage, other than a base, something really base for us to start to get involved with. So I've started discussion with two or three other venues in the UK to start to see about how to expand this and build other kind of remote control methods into their system that they've already bought some equipment, as I mentioned at the beginning. I think that the important stage is to understand, first of all, how to deal with lots of different types of equipment and build up a knowledge base within within our team, and then start to understand how to roll that out. But I think the Rupert's point at the beginning, the really exciting thing for me is building up a network of groups who then help each other and sell tickets for each other in a much more wider distribution pattern. Because that's, I think, if you can build up the financial backbone to something and the audience backbone, the community backbone, all those different elements, then, you know, doesn't matter what we're controlling or what we're buying or what we're selling.
Yeah, go ahead, Todd.
But it might just be interesting to talk about my situation, which is quite different than Richard's, in that he has a whole theater and already had a lot of equipment. I have a recording studio, so that's my audio. And I, because of office hours, I really did invest more deeply in ATEM hardware. So I have an ATEM Mini Extreme Pro. But when we decided to play this game, our team, I was simply sent a Meraki Z3 by Jim Hankins. He basically sent it to me in a box. Also sent me a streaming bridge so that we'd be able to bring in a guest. But it's really interesting to note that it's his networking capabilities, his networking knowledge, which basically put us all into that box and into my house. So that's really, in a way, all you need, assuming that the partners have, you know, adequate base gear. That's the one thing I didn't have and probably would not have been able to afford at the time, to say, hey, we can do this privately and securely, and we can all work together. So that, as the basis of the project, was enough.
Yeah, I think that if someone already has stuff, I think that you want to figure out a way to work with what they already have. But I will say that what would really benefit us is to take the learnings that we're making here and building recommended kits, so that if someone says, oh, I want to have my venue have this, or my studio have this, whether it's an individual or a venue, to have them have, this is what I can spend. Literally, some of them will be, I can spend $100,000 or $150,000 or $10,000 or $5,000 or $1,000. These are the things that you can do that will make it easier for us to tie in, and us to have that standardization. I also think that there's probably an opportunity for fly kits. You know, a kit that is like, this is the cameras, and we built these kits for a lot of companies, where roll it in and 45 minutes later, you're ready to do a show. And it's all pre-wired to do what it needs to do and to provide us with the access. So I think that those are probably two things. I do think that the opportunity is about to become massive for small venues and recording studios and so on and so forth to broadcast to other venues. So I think venue to venue and then venue to the internet are two very different opportunities, and they're going to get much, much larger if you look at it. I mean, I think that there was a recent event where you saw Kanye or Ye broadcast from the Coliseum to about 30 theaters. So that's a preview of what's coming. Next question.
Keith Harrison in London, England says, since the adoption of Universe, is the only requirement to participate a working internet connection and a web browser now?
Good. Dennis?
Almost. You can move the cameras and you can switch with just that. You would also want a connection to Zoom so you can see what you're doing, and to Unity comms so that you can coordinate with everyone else.
Good, Brian.
On a philosophical level, you also need to be able to communicate well. And I think that's what I've really taken away from working with everyone, is that being able to just have clear comms is a very important part of working remotely.
Good. Tlaloc?
And communication is key. And so it's very important that you have the Unity client somewhere in order to listen in and be able to work in that, you know, with those different PLs and be able to talk to the right people at the right time. And the other requirement, and I'm not trying to be flip, but it really is curiosity. You know, you got to kind of want to understand and build and get into it and figure it out.
Sky, real quick.
Yes, the Unity comms was huge this last week, because they were able to, Richard was able to feed the audio of the show into our interaction communications as well. And also that etiquette, to Tlaloc's point, of the curiosity, but at what part of the job do you feel you want to participate is a decision that you would want to observe and then practice and try.
Our next question.
Tommy Shantz in St. Paul, Minnesota is up next with, will a tablet work well for universal control on remote control for a Belfast-type production?
Go ahead, Brian.
Yes, we have used tablets before to be able to control both the 2ME and the PTZ. But just given the nature of the PTZ's many buttons, it's a lot easier to be able to use it on a browser window, on a laptop or a monitor, rather than a tablet. It's just way too many buttons. But the 2ME is a great great bit of software to use on the tablet.
Good, Brian. I'm sorry, next question.
Jason Panks in Nashville, Tennessee in the U.S. says, does an operator accessing Universe require a VPN, or is the Universe does the Universe PC have ports forwarded through the Ubiquiti USG Pro?
Go ahead, Jonas.
So for Universe, how it works right now, it's hosted by Manolo, and Manolo has something called a Cloudflare tunnel, which tunnels out that specific pod on his local host out to Cloudflare's cloud infrastructure over redundant connections, and then you can connect to their why we do it that way is there's access control built in, so you can restrict it to email addresses, sign on, or different other types. It's highly redundant, and also you can just shut it off as soon as we're done with it. You close the window, it's done, nobody has connection anymore, but you could totally also do it by port forwarding.
Next question.
Kenny Hampton in Greenville, Illinois says, in the theater with the wired PTZ cameras in conjunction with the wireless roving room cameras, how do you deal with latency and sync issues between all your sources?
Go ahead, Mickey.
So yeah, admittedly, we did the sync alignment only with the wired PTZ cameras, if I recall correctly, Richard. And we did not correct for any wireless feeds coming from cameras. It's just something we should probably work on. Though with all the systems not being genlocked, there will always be a variability there, because the ATEM is having to do frame sync with all the inputs coming in. Usually in a broadcast facility, you would have a rack of Links Technique chassis with a bunch of frame sync cards, or a rack of AJA FS units that will line up all the cameras. We don't have that here, but working on probably genlocking all the cameras is a more achievable step, I think, at this point.
Go ahead, Richard.
Yeah, I think genlocking is definitely a step, but where we're at right now, the latency on the wireless is really, really low. Like, it's incredibly low. I think it's within one frame at the moment, so it's pretty decent. Like, if you watch back in the previous shows, you might not be able to feel any difference at that low latency, but it's certainly something that we're looking at, mostly because I'm not massively happy with the wireless reception of those wireless kits, and we'll probably in the future look at something more robust.
Next question.
Andre Dalle in Berlin, Germany says, will there be security issues for the Belfast method related to log4j?
Go ahead, Richard.
At the moment, whenever that came out, we've re-updated the entire network with the patches from Ubiquiti. So as far as we know, we're pretty secure. It will take a couple more checks in the new year to make sure, but I don't think so. Also, there's an added benefit to the fact that we run through Manolo. So everything comes from Manolo and then to us.
I go with Mickey.
Yeah, I was just about to mention that update all your networking appliances, including all Unify lines, that all Ubiquiti lines. That's what I'm going to be doing on the 25th, on Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah. Next question.
Merry Christmas.
Douglas Carmichael's up next. He said, could you see a broadcast level video equipment, for example, Grass Valley Group or Ross, being Belfastable with the proper software in between to talk to it?
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, a lot of these more industry standard or higher end hardware have their own protocols for control. It may not be something that you can control via software, but they have very proprietary hardware that you can use to control things remotely.
You heard Jonas?
Yes, Universe just released an update today, which includes ROS Talk, which is the protocol that ROS uses for their switches, and it's a pretty standard in that industry. So totally.
Yep. Go, Richard.
I think it's probably worth noting that without using Blackmagic, I don't know if we would have got to the stage that we're at. It's highly adaptable system. It's a camera control integration with the Ursus. It's a software control, all the different things. I don't know if we ever, if we had a Roland system of a similar scale, I don't think we would have ever got to this stage. It's been, even the integration with MixEffect Pro, I mean, it's just fantastic. And it's entry level. So the idea that we're talking about now controlling small venues is that we can send an i10 mini or TV studio or a 1ME to a smaller venue. You know, it's not the same level of integration. So you know, I know the question is about broadcast level, but it, I think a massive shout out to Blackmagic making a lot of this doable.
Next question.
Vincent Gerald in Louisiana says, any noteworthy differences between using Parsec and AnyDesk?
Go ahead, Tlaloc.
I find that Parsec is a little bit snappier than AnyDesk, and that's why we ended up moving into it for Belfast lighting control, because when there's latency in just the controls and commands onto the lighting software, it's infuriating. So we want it to be as quick as we can, just in terms of mouse clicks and keyboard clicks. But Parsec is limited because it only allows you to look at one monitor at a time. And the other thing is that it's very, very susceptible to not working when you're in a weird situation of double NATs or firewalls, where today I wanted to use Parsec to show you guys, could not. So I used AnyDesk and it cut right through.
Right. Mickey?
Yeah, definitely the latency. I use TeamViewer and AnyDesk quite a bit. And it doesn't compare to how snappy Parsec is. I think followed by Parsec, nice VNC might be a second contender, but Parsec is just so much better.
Go, Rupert.
You know, we have a good relationship with Parsec, with them coming on for the second hour. I'd be really interested to have them look at what we're doing here and see if they can help us.
Yeah, absolutely. Next question.
Matt Cool in Montreal, Quebec, Canada says, how have you dealt with latency in camera switches, lighting changes, and so forth?
I go ahead, Dennis.
What latency? Since we moved to Universe, it has been almost instant. When we were using the Stream Decks to control it, or for that matter, Panasonic's own software to control the cameras, it was laggy. You know, you'd press a button and wait 2 seconds before something happened. There was a famous incident right at the start of a show where I was getting a camera lined up. We cut to the camera and it just shot straight to the ceiling. Since we've moved to Universe, everything has behaved. You've always got control. And you know, the only latency you're really seeing is the sort of quarter of a second in Zoom to actually see the image come up in right. The multi-view.
Yep, good. Tlaloc.
Lighting, I think, the latency of the music is important. And so thinking about where you're getting your audio feed from is very important. Are you getting it from the program feed within Unity Comms, or are you getting it from Zoom or through Unity Connect? And so what you want to try to do is be listening to the latency, least latency amount of music for the music coming into your ears, because I'm trying to, you know, respond a little bit to the music. And then try not to do any jump cuts in the lighting, because we're not spot on and it won't work.
Right. Sky, real quick.
Yeah. Music is an emotional medium. And so how do we show that visually is because you don't have movement happening inside the camera. So do you want to have the camera do a move? And that's what's been really exciting in the last few weeks, is watching the camera operators test this new equipment, test these new systems, and allowing that movement to happen to allow the caller to set up and preset some shots. And because, again, as been stated, Unity's given that latency issue that we had early on, it's not an issue anymore. So you can be more creative in the camera movement, but also the camera operators are becoming much more sensitive to finding a good image.
Next question.
James Hutchinson in Dublin, Ireland says, can the show operators be separate to the technical team? If not, how close are you to achieving that so that any operators can step into a show at short notice and with minimal setup?
All right, go ahead, Brian.
So I believe we're already there. What's great about this is that Richard gives us all an opportunity to try different roles, whether that be the PTZ operator or switching or even calling. And the more you turn up, the more practice you get, and you're able to jump in and swap roles even between scenes within the show as well. So yeah, it's a great opportunity. I think we're going really well with that.
Go ahead, Richard.
I think Brian's spot on. I don't think, unless it was an emergency, I would bring in an operator for a main show at short notice anyway, with minimal setup. I would want people to evolve through the Belfast Method process, as in come in, start to shadow, have a watch, have a fun, have a play, start to learn the system, jump on, give it a try, then start to go up to the main shows. In terms of technical knowledge, you don't have to be hugely knowledgeable to understand what's happening, but just as you know, as Lalok said, you have to be curious and interested and dedicated. It does take quite a lot of time to go from zero to hero, and you know, Brian is a testament to that. It did take a lot of Brian's investment to turn up, and especially at certain hours of the day for New South Wales, to come in and to experiment. So I think we're very close to achieving people to kind of come in at any stage. And one of the things we did at the very, very beginning was people could just come into the Zoom room and call the show. We haven't done that in a while because we've moved on to a slightly different methodology. But you know, come in, get involved, and you'll see what it's like.
Next question.
James Hutchinson in Dublin, Ireland is up next, and he says, the technical setup and back-end support seems detailed and very specialized. Do you rely on a consistent core team? And if so, how many people and how transferable is the back-end setup from one show to the next?
Go ahead, Richard.
I don't think it's too specialized. I think it's grown up around what we're doing, but I don't think it's specialized to just what we're doing. What we've tried to develop and what I've put a focus on is developing a system that can adapt very quickly to lots of different things. So even getting the video hub is an example of that. So we can easily change from doing a remote broadcast system where live view is the main kind of camera feed to over to a Zoom ISO system, moving over to a in theater based system with a couple of flicks of what the video hub routing is doing. In terms of the core team, there are a lot of consistent people who show up and then their knowledge builds over the weeks within the Belfast shows, but and we rely upon very heavily upon their knowledge base to help us learn from each other, but there's also a huge room for new people to come in, and we slowly onboard people as we've done in the last couple of weeks. So I've tried to design a system as a person who runs a venue that does not rely upon the expertise outside of our building, because we cannot, you know, we cannot at our scale pay everyone a decent wage to come in and remote control our system. So therefore, I have to be aware that at any stage, because it's a voluntary system, we could be down to one person, or we could be down to no people, or we could have 20. And that's what we tried to design the system to scale between, is that sometimes one person might help us, and sometimes no one might be able to hear to help us, and you know. It's designed to be as flexible as I can make it.
Next question.
Marty Adius in Maryland says, audio is an essential part of these broadcasts. Can Mickey talk about how mixing is set up?
Go ahead, Marty, and then Mickey.
Yeah, as a music show, I think we ought to give audio some time. And being one of the mixers on the show, I know that audio control and monitoring in real time is continuing to be developed. So I wanted to give Mickey and Richard a chance to talk about that.
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, within the theater, the board that is used as a Behringer X32, depending on what show is being done and if there is an in-house audience or not, we're either mixing the stream mix on the main left and right bus, or sometimes into a totally separate bus that is specifically for the stream mix. Control has been, at the moment, quite not as fancy as Universe and all that. We are running X32 Edit locally, and we are VPN'd into the Accidental Theater Network, and we're using MIDI controllers to control the X32 using that app. I hope to get time to experiment with an app that Jonas reminded me of, which is Mixing Station. I'm hoping to get to that sometime within the holiday break, although that time has been quickly been going away. But yeah, that's pretty much the gist of it, I think.
It's amazing how we fill up all of our time, no matter what. Go ahead, Richard.
Yeah, I think it's worth noting that everything's in constant evolution. And so how we're deciding to do a lot of the Belfast stuff has been done without audience because there's been restrictions and bringing an audience into it. So now we're starting to bring audiences back into the shows. We're starting to learn, okay, where do we want to mix it? Which bus do we want to mix it? How many buses do we need for FX and things like that? Can we do, how do we do this as we introduce these different variables? And the board and the control and what we're trying to do and the communication around it is all evolving generally and gently as we move forward bit by bit. So there's lots of new things that we're discovering, how to communicate what's existing in the system, how to communicate the fact that there's other shows the day before, the day after, the day off sometimes, that will be on the board at the same time. As an example, when we did the Saturday, Marty was mixing the audio from the cooking show on the X32 rack in the basement so that the X32 in the theater could be left alone for the A1 Marty to set up and get ready for the show later on. So there's a lot of different things that we're playing with, and how we can integrate these different options in the future will become really exciting.
Next question.
Tony Mobley in Noonan, Georgia asks, I know a lot of us may be done with talking about Super Saturday, but I'm still in awe. What's next, Richard?
Go ahead, Richard.
There's quite a lot in the offing. I was having an interesting discussion with Todd yesterday about all the different things that we're going to play with between the Todd Reynolds Live and between the accidental shows and all the different things. So I think what next will be, let's see who else wants to play, who else wants to learn. That we'll get back and running in the new year, and I might have some interesting things down the line to suggest. We'll see what the birding show turns into.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the more we can do it, the more we can figure out what's going on, like, and how to get it done and how to make it predictable. And the more we look at using the same systems in different ways, I think it's really important. Next question.
Douglas Carmichael says, many U.S. jurisdictions have exempted workers in video and telecommunications systems from restrictions during an emergency situation. Could the Belfast Method universe be applied to traditional broadcast, for example, TV and radio, as a model to make it more resilient?
I mean, I think it can. I mean, I think that's, as we get it figured out, it's going to be something that we use more and more and more. I mean, in almost every production I have now, we're distributed somewhere in the world. Like, there's no productions I do anymore that have everybody in one place, and it used to be all of them were like that. We don't even think that way anymore. So I think that this is just going to keep growing. Next question.
Douglas Carmichael has our last one today. The Allen Heath D-Live has a multi-surface mode, which enables separate roles, front of house, monitor, and stream, on a single mix engine per controller. Would that be useful for the method to reduce clashes between engineers where one steps on the other's settings?
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, the multi-surface mode on the Allen Heath consoles run on their, I think they call it the Giga Ace network, which is a proprietary control and audio transport network that doesn't run on standard IP networks. So in terms of distributing the more segmented roles over the internet or around the world, it wouldn't work that way. But I think there are ways to do it with other methods.
So a big thank you to the whole team, Richard and everybody else that's working on the Belfast Method. Just a really, really great presentation. Thanks for getting us up to speed on how you guys are approaching this and what you're doing with it. It's really fascinating. You know, I do think that we talked a little bit about this on Saturday, but I really feel like eventually they're going to write a book or something or do a documentary about the crazy stuff that we're doing here, because it's changing the way we think about doing content production. You know, and I think that the only way for us to do it is to figure it out the way we're doing it. And so, so I just want to thank everybody for being our own guinea pigs and figuring out how to make this work and failing forward and failing less every day and having it more effective every day. And it's just amazing to watch. And I think that Saturday was a culmination of a lot of skill sets that had slowly been coming together. And I think we just want to look for more of those opportunities. and the content gets better too. I mean, it's not just that, oh, we're technically figuring it out. What makes this great is that we're getting great content. Like that it's actually interesting to watch because, and that's what, so I want to thank also the artists, you know, that in Belfast and Todd and Tony and, you know, everyone who's doing the, and Hosmuk doing, you know, and all of these artists making something that's actually interesting. Because the hardest thing to do is to test this stuff on boring, you know, like that's what happens when you do R&D. You're like, oh, we'll have somebody up there going check, check, one, two, and trying to make something up. It's just so much more powerful when you're really trying to produce something that's worth watching. So it's really just a hats off to everyone there.
Jim and JJ.
Yeah, and JJ. And anyway, so for our producers, thank you for the great content and the great questions and pulling that conversation together. And for our panelists, of course, there's a lot of panelists today. Thanks for your contribution to everyone and really giving back to the rest of the community. Tomorrow, of course, we'll talk about shoestring budgets. And then, of course, we are doing education on Saturday. And then finally, 2 o'clock today and tomorrow, we'll be Pacific Standard Time, we'll be doing some more Isadora Labs with Elle. So so stay tuned for that. Yeah, we'll go from there. Now we're going to jump into After Hours. See you there.